Sphere geopolitics. And these are some of the notes I've actually been putting together, and it's actually quite interesting. But the thing is, it takes you off into tangents, into directions that you don't necessarily... this is the whole thing about research. None of what I'm talking about was actually, in terms of finding and sort of seeing the parallels and using examples, was actually anticipated. I didn't anticipate that this would be found. This is, what I'm talking about is the result, my views now, are the result of what I've found, of what I've seen, of the information, the research that I've gathered. And this is why the notes are important. The notes are important because it is the presentation, it is the organization, in some ways, of the research that you did. And now, initially, they're ad hoc. They're all over the place. They're a mess. They're not organized, because that's the way thoughts come out. When you're doing that research, it's just, you know, you take a note here, you take a note there. They're not specifically organized. They simply come in a chronological order. So you take your first note, then you take your second note, third note. As you move on the research, you're down to your nth note by the time you finish what you're doing. So you have all these notes that now have to be put together and organized. And this is what creates some of the problems that after the research is done and you're fatigued like this, and I'm now knocked out for an entire day, that the organization of the notes does take a little bit longer, and it sort of holds up filming and shooting of various different shows, because the notes haven't been properly organized enough so that I can go down and, okay, let's start filming some of these shows. So that's how the note taking sort of impacts on the shows and the filming schedule here. I think I'm going to leave it here for now. I'm going to do my last little bit of hydration, and then I'll probably end up going back to bed. We'll see what ends up happening for the rest of the day. I'm trying to get caught up. But we'll see what the progress is by, I think, 5 o'clock in the morning. And it's not going to be good night or good morning now. The entire schedule's been thrown off. That's out the window now. I'm in, we'll call, particularly if you start seeing these gaps like this, I'm in, this is called red button or red light emergency mode. I mean, I just red light. I just went up all the way up to red, all the way up to fail-safe shutdown. And this is the result of it. I'm now in recovery mode. I crashed, and this is the result. You're seeing the result now. It seems to be better than it was before, but who knows? We'll see what happens. We'll see a couple days from now. We'll see where I am, or actually in a couple days, a couple hours from now. We'll see where I am and make an assessment then. Anyways, I will see you in the next segment of the Big Bang Theory of BTS vlog. Bye. Well, good morning, everybody. I guess I'm kind of a cheery person regardless when I talk to a person, so I guess that's kind of what keeps me going. The reason why I say that, it is 9 hours and 54 minutes into the day of Saturday, April 23rd, 2016. Yeah, sometimes I do get my time and date stamp wrong. But fortunately, there's enough other segments where I do get the date right, that if I do get one wrong, it becomes obvious, and you can use the bracketing segments to sort of correct for the time. And it's not necessarily the time. The time is right because I can see the time. It's the date, trying to remember the date that, even if I've just seen it like 5 minutes ago, sometimes I'll see the date, then come back and try to remember it. And it's just that initial, what I just saw is completely gone. In other words, the date that I should have known is not there anymore. Or should have remembered. There's been a gap in vlogging. I think there's about a day's worth of gap. I'm not really too sure. I'm not really too sure of the time right now, actually, in terms of the day or night, in terms of how I feel. It's another long night of research. And the thing is, when I talk about long night, I can do 12 hours. That's not a problem. Problem is when it starts, 12 hours is my limit right now. And the problem is when I go beyond the 12 hours, particularly if I'm doing it multiple days in a row. And this is the way research goes. You can't anticipate what you're going to find, particularly if you're doing open research. You're not sort of putting any bias or restrictions on what you're doing in research, allowing your research to take you in the direction that, you know, you think you should be going in. You know, in other words, you're not dictating the direction that your research is going in. The research is, your observations are dictating the next direction. So there isn't a fundamental direction. I mean, I was watching part of a, you know, and the research went all over the place. I was watching Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's one of the spokespersons for NASA, and he was talking about ignorance and atheism, you know, how religious people are ignorant, and that it fosters ignorance. And the thing is, he admits that some of the best scientists in the world were believed in God. And he said, well, there are limitations. And so because Newton didn't figure something out, he missed something in his research that other scientists did pick up. Well, he's ignorant. And it's because of religion he's ignorant. Really? Is Neil at the level of Newton? Is he at the level of Einstein? Because Einstein had believed in God. He had this sort of issue with theology and religion, but his decision wasn't that God didn't exist at the end of his observation of religion. And in any case, he participated as well, and he was a Catholic for a bit, he was a Jew for a bit, and then at the end, it sort of became there is a God, because this is what was his stumbling block to quantum mechanics is that he didn't believe, and he said that God played dice with the universe. And that's why he couldn't, you know, move from because they classify him as a classical scientist. But I think he's not necessarily a classical scientist. He did a lot more than simply just what classical. He's the one who he's if you look at these things as boundaries between different sciences, the evolution of science, if you will. He sits at a boundary line. And that boundary line is either closed or open. Now, the classical boundary line says the door is closed, that there's nothing more beyond this boundary, and that you've reached the end of the universe. Then you can say, I know this and I know that. And this is the situation, because he was talking about the Erwin Hubble and the expansion of the universe. Well, no. the Hubble cannot state, nor can anyone else say, that the universe is expanding or contracting, simply because it appears. I mean, this is their argument. Let's compare the argument here. They say, for a fact, scientific fact, the universe is expanding. Well, this is what the scientists say. So this is what science says. Okay. Well, where's your evidence? Oh, don't you know? When they looked at the stars, he measured the stars, what he could see. He could see all the stars moving away from him. So therefore, the universe is expanding. That must be an obvious conclusion. All right, let's go back to 1000 AD, to the Ptolemies, to the scientists who worked on the calendar. What did they see? They saw the stars, the moon, the planet, and the sun moving around the Earth. That's what they saw. Their conclusion was that the Earth was in the center of the universe and everything else revolved around the sun. That was their observational view. Turned out they're wrong. But they couldn't conceive that they were wrong. Why? Because this is what their observation showed them. They hadn't seen anything outside of their observation that would contradict this. So they assumed that our logic, which was because they were a logic-based society, Aristotle invented, not really invented, but brought in a lot more of a logical-based view of things. And this is what the Hellenes, the work of Alexander the Great, who invented Hellenism. Hellenism was created by Alexander the Great. People say, oh, he's Macedonian. No, he's not Macedonian. He's Hellenic. Why is he Hellenic? Why is he Greek? Why is he, alas, zito alas? Why? Because he invented it. He created Hellenism. How can a person who created Hellenism be simply a Macedonian? And Macedonia didn't exist at that time. Macedonia was one of his generals who he put in charge of that particular area. So there, before Alexander the Great, there was no Macedonia. Because how could he have the general who he named that area after? If that general didn't exist because he hadn't become a soldier yet, he hadn't started leading his army, he hadn't done his great conquests. If there was no Macedonia general, and that's a name, that's a person's name, Macedonia is the person's, the general's name. That part of Greece, that part of the Hellenic Empire, is named after that general. Without that general, there is no Macedonia. But if you look at our textbooks, the great Archimedes, you know, he's a Macedonian. And of course, people will tell you, you have to trust in science, you have to trust in... This is what's in the textbooks. And this is why I say you need to start looking outside the textbooks. Maybe the textbooks are more often not wrong. When you're reading a textbook, you're reading somebody's view on what happened, on what the thing is. You're reading somebody's opinion. And this is the same thing true with global warming. Global warming is not a scientific fact. It's presented as a fact, but it's basically somebody's opinion. And it's become a... And this is how it becomes a... This is how, some, in many cases, this is how science opinion... This is how big opinion becomes scientific fact. Because enough people, it becomes popular enough. This is a popular view. And because it's popular, this is what we talk about, you have to read a popular science magazine, or you have to read a popular science, or you have to get into popular science. This is the popular view. It's not science itself. This is a religion. This is a belief. And the thing that, why I say it's a religion, because anything you practice religiously, anything you look at and accept unquestioned, is a religion, particularly if there are restrictions that are enforced upon you, where you say you can't read this, you can't see that, you can't see that. And ironically enough, in the early Christian church, prior to 1000 AD, and this is why I say you have to really look into your history. Most of these atheists haven't looked into. In fact, most of these atheists are kind of, I would say, they've created their own form of ignorance. Because they won't accept any other view. And I've seen this with this nerd and geek on the internet who's talking about this, saying how he became an atheist and how this and that and that, you know. And he said, well, you know, I don't mind Christians who believe the way I believe. I mean, you know, if a Christian has a question about the Bible or they don't believe in this and they don't, you know, they pick and choose what they want to believe in Christianity, then he's all right with that. But how about sitting down and studying? And they said, well, I don't need to prove my atheism to you. I'm beyond that. Really? I'm 50 now, so I can say this. That they back then. This guy's this is a kid, and he's a child who's wet between the ears. He's got barely a bachelor's degree. His primary resource that you can see in his room are comic books. So his fundamental sources of reading are comic books. And he is now the professor of the universe, who dictates what is ignorance and what is not ignorance, and declares himself not to be ignorant. I find some of this stuff amusing. It would be amusing if it didn't have fundamental and serious consequences to it. And the thing is, so as you're going through this stuff, he starts talking about, and he's got this YouTube channel where this is the problem. He's got this YouTube channel that's professing to tell people the truth. He's exposing the lies. Without downing on the fact that a large chunk of the universities were initially government universities, in terms of the American system. A large chunk of the universities prior to the American system were all church-sponsored universities. In other words, they were set up by the Jesuits. They were set up by the Catholic sphere of existence. And they have a heavily biased view. In other words, he hasn't questioned the authorities to which he believes are absolutely true. Yes, they're not Christian. Yes, they are, in many cases, atheists, but he hasn't done what he expects Christians to do. Question your authorities. When somebody is telling you something, go in, do a study, research it. Is the person telling the truth? You don't have to be mean and rude about it. Another thing is if you're going to question authority, you have to sit down and do your homework. You have to do the research. You have to do what I'm doing here. And that means sleepless nights. And when you have enough sleepless nights, and this is my case here, this is not that I'm being forced to do this. It's the research drives you forward. When you start finding good information, you want to continue forward. It's like a video game. Unless I view it as a video game. You don't want to stop. It's like 5 more minutes, 5 more minutes, 5 more minutes. And by the time the 5 more minutes is up, in this case, it was close to 5 o'clock in the morning. I mean, how often do I say, I didn't finish research till noon. I didn't finish research doing the work. I was working all night until 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And that's when I went to bed. I mean, this is why my schedule is completely screwed up. This is research. This is going to find the truth. And I think most of these scientists have no concept of history prior to 1000 AD. In other words, their entire view of history is from the European perspective. They have no concept that there is an Eastern Christian. And then this is Neil deGrasse Tyson, who is the genius, who knows more than Einstein, who knows more than Sir Isaac Newton, who knows more than Huygens, who knows more than Laplace. He knows more than all these people there, because these people who were religious were all ignorant to him. These were people who were ignorant. This is how he demonstrates how religion in science creates ignorance. This is his view. And I watched him in the lecture saying this. I'm actually going to put in the more developed vlogs called InstaVlogs, where I produce a much more organized formation of my notes. This is what's going to come in. And I will show you video of him actually stating this. he couldn't believe, and he calls the pre-Christian Arabic world Muslim. And he talks about how from 800 AD to about 1000 AD that the Muslim world collapsed because of the ignorance of religion. Fundamentally, what he was talking about, if he actually knew his history, he knew that the Arabs, who were barbarians, they were the Bedouins, they were the nomads of the desert, began raiding places, and this is the reason why 800 to 1000 AD, around that point there, you have this, is this at 700 AD, this is when Muhammad began his expansion out. If you look at Islamic history, they don't have a 0 AD. They have a 0 AD, if you want to call it this, at 700 AD, right? You can't use that. You can't use Christ as a standard for time. I says, why not? They use something called the common era. Well, which common era? To which era are we common to? Are we common to the Roman Catholic era? Right? The emergence of the papacy, which began in 1000 AD. In other words, we're simply in the millennium. We've only gone 1,000 years into the, you know, past the emergence of the papacy. Are we 1300 years? We begin at our zero point is beginning at the beginning of Muhammad. That's what they have. To which era are we common to? And there is no definition to the common era. The common era, if you will look at it carefully, simply is a replacement for AD and BC and AD. That's what it's a replacement for. And it sits exactly mapped on top of this. So the common era that it is defined as is Christ. It's the fundamental definition of the common era for that they're using is Christ. If you look at how they're calibrating their scale, it's a Christian scale. They're simply not acknowledging this. They're hiding the fact, this is a Christian scale, by calling it, this is the common era. So they go, and then you have the CE, common era, then you have the before common era, BCE. You'll see this in textbooks. But the thing is, because of the fact it works exactly along the same scale of BC and AD, and BC stands for before Christ, and AD basically it's Latin for after Christ, or it's Anno Domini, right? That's the AD, Anno Domini. That's the Latin for this. And he's starting his point and saying that the world collapsed of mathematics and engineering at its peak at about 800 AD, when the Muslims were just coming out. They started at 700, they became out in 800. If you study your history back, if you go have access to a Greek textbook, you have access to the history of the Byzantine Empire, which is in the Harvard University. Harvard has an entire library called Dumbarton Notes. Huge library. No, I think I got the name right. It's along those lines. That's Harvard University's massive library. They have a whole section on Byzantine and antiquities. Huge section on Byzantine and antiquity studies. Huge section. If he had done a sliver of research in there, he would have known that the era before the Arab Muslims, before 700 AD, was an Eastern Christian world. That they were Christian. They weren't Western Christian. They weren't the papacy. They were pre-papacy. The world only became Western Christian, papal Christian, at 1500 AD. 1500 AD is when what they call, you can talk about the Christian rite. The fundamental Christians have their zero point at 1500 AD, beginning with the dominance over the Eastern world by the Europeans after the Crusades and into the Spanish Inquisition. 1,500 years after Christ. Their zero point is 1,500 years after Christ. To accept that the Western understanding of Christianity as fact is to ignore 1,500 years of history. This is Neil deGrasse Tyson talking about the ignorance of religion. And I agree, religion does make a person ignorant, including the religion of science. If you believe in science, you're not following the research. If you're using the research to reinforce what you already believe, and this is what happens with the planet science, this is what happens.
I am the professor. And professor of what? Professor of physics.
Oh, say, can you see?
Speech rules here at Democratic Earth.